Good afternoon. It is one more time a tremendous blessing for us to be able to stand together and study the Word of God. How amazing it is that God has unfolded himself in such a way in his Word that as we listen attentively and are guided by his Spirit, we have a clear understanding of who he is and who we can be accordingly. Let us start our lesson with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we pause once again. In the name that's above every name, the Lord Jesus Christ, thanking you because of him, we have this marvelous privilege to approach you and this special place you set aside for us, your throne of grace. We now enter into your throne of grace, Father, asking that you would forgive us so that we're in alignment with your will, and we can have perfect fellowship and communion with you. Father, we pray that you would enlighten us, allow your Spirit to speak directly to our hearts, our minds, and then transform our lives so that we look more and more like the Lord Jesus Christ with the passing of each moment. Thank you once again for being your child. Let your Spirit guide our study, and let your will be done in and through us. In the name of Jesus, even the Christ, your Son, we do pray. Amen. This week we're looking at praise for salvation over in Acts chapter 2, beginning with the 32nd verse. In fact, we'll be looking specifically at the 32nd and 33rd verse, and then verses 37 through 47. Salvation is one of the most important concepts of Christianity. It defines the establishing and development of the key eternal relationship between the Creator of all things and the capstone of his creation, mankind. It is something that cannot afford to be misunderstood or mishandled. The Bible and the Lord Jesus Christ make it very clear that there are not multiple options for salvation. The Bible stated, "Nor is there salvation in any other name, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." In other words, Christ is it. And then Jesus himself admonished, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." Thus, according to the Bible, Jesus Christ is the gatekeeper to salvation. It makes it extremely important to communicate the precise message of salvation and not get sidetracked into areas that may confuse and not convict a person of their need for an opportunity to receive salvation. This week's lesson spotlights the specifics of the salvation message and emphasizes its preciseness. It continues the highlight of on praise in this unit, with attention being directed toward praising the Lord for the amazing gift of salvation. The lesson is found in Acts chapter 2, which unfolds the incredible story of the birth of the church with the coming of the Holy Spirit. It then begins to unwrap the mission of the church with the sharing of the gospel message that is the centerpiece of salvation. Our lesson text, as we mentioned earlier, is Acts chapter 2, verses 32 to 33, and verses 37 through 47. These verses read thusly, starting with verse 32. "This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear." Dropping down to verse 37. "Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, 'Men and brethren, what shall we do?' Then Peter said to them, 'Repent. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call.' And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, 'Be saved from this perverse generation.' Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Amen to God's word. Let us join me in analyzing the text by looking at first the proclamation, then the penetration, and finally the propagation. First of all, let's look at the proclamation in verses 32 and 33. First of all, the person. Notice what it says. It said in verse 33 that this Jesus God has raised up, which you all have witnessed it. Let's put this in context. It said, this Jesus, God has raised up. What they're referencing is the Lord Jesus Christ had been crucified. 3 days later, he got up. He was raised up. And then we went through this 50-day period leading up to Pentecost, in which he eventually ascended. And then 10 days later was Pentecost. What had happened is, as we mentioned, if you go through the verses, it'll elaborate more, indicating that Peter, in this sermon, this is actually the first sermon that initiates the birth of the church. In effect, the birth was technically born in the upper room with 120, and then we saw this expansion with Peter sharing this sermon. And it reminds us of what we're told in the Bible. People are saved by the foolishness of preaching. And Peter had gotten up and shared that Jesus Christ had been persecuted, had been oppressed, had been crucified. And he pointed to the fact that they all had responsibility, those who were there. By the way, remember, we alluded to the fact that this was Pentecost. This was a time in which the Jewish people from around the world, those who had been scattered, as they referred to as the diaspora from around the world, were expected to come into Jerusalem to celebrate at this particular point in time. So we have people from all over the world, Jews from all over the world, as well as proselytes, those who were following Judaism, former Gentiles who were following Judaism. They had all assembled here to celebrate Pentecost. And so Peter is indicating to them, and by the way, they had to be aware of the fact that something unusual had happened during this period, that Christ had been crucified, that this buzz about this person had been permeating throughout the world, and then all of a sudden this person was crucified. And there were these question marks about who he was and his relevance. And it looked as though on the surface that he had appeared and disappeared. But now all of a sudden Peter is letting them know that's not the case. The same Jesus had gotten up. God had raised him up. That's what he's referring to in verse 32. God had raised him up, even though those who were standing there, Peter pointed to as being responsible for him being crucified. And what Peter is really doing is establishing a case that will convict them that we will see later on they responded to. So this is the person, the Lord Jesus Christ, who had been about 3 years plus walking and sharing the good news that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He had done these miracles and these wonders, and now he had been persecuted and crucified, and shockingly, he had gotten up 3 days later. And notice what Peter said toward the end of verse 32. of which we are all witnesses. This is not hearsay. Peter is letting them know that he is not sharing something that he heard and he might not be sure about the legitimacy of it. But what he's saying is he observed for himself that the same Jesus that was crucified got up. And you, as you can imagine, that is a very unique something. People don't die and get back up. So this is one of the strengths, one of the focal points of his sermon that Peter is sharing, that Christ was crucified, but yet God got him up out of the grave. Then he goes on to talk about the position that Christ is in now in verse 33, where he says, therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise, having received from the Father the promise of the Spirit, and we'll get to that. He poured it out, which he now sees. So we'll look at, first of all, the position, then we'll look at the promise. The position now, the Lord Jesus Christ not only has been raised from the dead, but now he has ascended and is sitting, notice it says, at the right hand of the Father. A position of authority. A position that makes it very known how pleased God was with him. Imagine from one day going from one who was looked at as being something that somebody we need to get rid of and crucifying, and now he's sitting in this exalted position at the right hand of the Father. So the person of Christ has been raised up, and now he's been exalted. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father in this great authoritative position that he sits at. And then he goes on and talks about the promise, in which he says that Christ, because of what he's done, remember earlier in this sermon, Peter alluded to Joel saying that the Spirit will be poured out. Now this is going to that promise. Now what Peter is relating at this promise of the Spirit coming and being poured out on mankind is now a reality instead of just a promise. And then he has poured it out, on which you now see and hear what he's referencing. Remember, in the upper room, there was 120 in the upper room after Christ had ascended, waiting on him, waiting on the promise that Christ indicated to them. Because Christ told them that ye shall receive power, after which you shall be witnesses. And this power was the Holy Spirit. And so they were in the upper room, 120 of them, and the Spirit of God came, and you look early in chapter 2 where it references the Spirit of God came when he did like cloven tongues, these visible like tongues of fire that were seen, displaying his presence. And then it was a violent a rushing winds that could be heard everywhere. And then they spoke in tongues, in other words, in other languages, if you look real closely, one of the interesting things to me is here are men from Galilee who were speaking, and then people from all over the world. They had people from Rome. They had people from Egypt. They had people from Phrygia. They had people from all over the world, Jews from all over the world. And amazingly, these who were in the upper room who had been, the Holy Spirit came and indwelled them, and they began to speak in other tongues. And as they would speak, a Persian would be able to hear in their language. A Mede would be able to hear in his language. A Roman would be able to hear in Latin. An Egyptian would be able to hear in the Egyptian language. That is what is strange enough for a person to speak and not aware of the language in which they speak, and then someone is able to hear it. But then for everyone to be able to hear this language. So we see again this manifestation of this promise of the Holy Spirit that will reach out. The Spirit of God will reach out and become a part of those who were responsive to the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we first of all looked at this proclamation where we looked at the person, the position, and the promise. Now let us look at the penetration. What really happened as those who were standing there and for the first time were hearing about the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ and this ugly event that with him being crucified actually was a glorious something that had come from God that allowed them the opportunity to get to know God through the Lord Jesus Christ. What penetration does it have? Let's look at that. So we'll be looking at verses 37 through 41. Notice what it says there. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said to them, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit," this promise. "For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call." And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, "Be saved from this perverse generation." Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. So, let's first of all look at the response. It says, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. This message of Christ coming, Christ being crucified, in effect by them for their sin, and Christ getting up and offering for them an opportunity to have a relationship with God, so penetrated them that they responded with this question, "What shall we do?" One of the things that we have to keep in mind is as we are going out to interact with those who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, it's imperative that we live in a Christ-like way to get people's attention. But ultimately, we have to share the word of God or direct them to where this word about who Christ was and what he did and how he has positioned them so that they are able to come to God if they accept him must be shared, because ultimately salvation is a work of God, a work of the Holy Spirit. Spirit of God has to take the word of God, touch, convict a person so that they turn and say, "I want to know him. I want him to be the one who allows me to partake of life and what life is truly about." So they were so convicted when they heard this message that they had been responsible because of their sinfulness, because of their unconcern about God, had been responsible for the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason he died was because of their sins, the things that they had done in to disobey and be in disagreement with God. But now, this news, this good news, this message that was shared was used by the Spirit of God to touch their heart and put them in a position to say, "What should we do with this that we know? What difference can this make to us?" And though, so they asked the question, "What shall we do?" And you know, as Peter's a good preacher. Hey, I got an answer for that. I got an answer for what you need. So then, what we see is the relevance of what Peter was saying. Peter then said to them, "Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far, as many as the Lord our God will call. So what we see is that Peter now lets them know that there is a reason, that God had a purpose behind allowing the Lord Jesus Christ to be crucified. And his purpose was for them to look at themselves and recognize that they are off base and they are inconsistent with the wishes of God. They are being disobedient. And what they need to do is repent. And that is stop doing what you're doing, the things that are wrong, and then turn away from them and turn toward God so his righteousness and goodness can be manifested. And then once you had made that commitment, then be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. Now let's pause here a moment. Some will look at this and think that this is saying that you have to be baptized to be saved. You're actually baptized because you're saved. Salvation happens the moment you repent or indicate, I'm through, I don't want to continue in the direction I'm going, I want to go in the direction that God leads me. And at that moment that you accept Christ as your substitute, the one who died for your sins and eliminated them, then at that moment you are saved and the Spirit of God moves in to indwell in your life. However, you are commissioned to then let the world know what has happened, and that is you would get baptized. Baptism is something that you can't do all the time. You know, for example, look at the thief on the cross, the one who indicated, asked the Lord to remember him, and the Lord said, today you'll be with me in paradise. He didn't have a chance yet to get baptized. But when you can, you should. Now, during this pandemic, of course, baptism is something we have not been able to do. But don't let that be a concern. If you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, repent of your sin. Ask God to forgive you for your sin. And say you want to turn away from them and turn toward him and accept Christ. You are saved. And as soon as we have the opportunity, we will make baptism available. And you can look forward to it. And please, when you do have a chance to get baptized, get baptized. And then, and notice that in the name of Jesus. And in fact, over in Matthew, the Great Commission, he concludes this, that baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So baptism is one of the two key ordinances. In fact, the ordinances that we celebrate here at Mount Olive. Baptism and the Lord's Supper. So it's important when we have the opportunity for us to be baptized. And basically what it's doing is allowing us to have, in effect, a public confession that I have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he goes on and indicates that this promise of receiving the Spirit is something that happens to, and he said, to you and your children, he's speaking to the Jews, that those who accepted Christ, the promise of the Holy Spirit, would be there. The Spirit would indwell them, would become a part of their life. But notice it also said, and to all who are far off, indicating that us, who are Gentiles, would have an opportunity if we did the same thing. That is, repent and accept the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent and acknowledge that our sins have been forgiven because of his perfect work. We are part of this family and will receive the Holy Spirit as well. And notice, it's kind of a twofold thing. It speaks of the human responsibility to repent. But it also lets us know it's a work of God. For notice, it closes out by saying, as many as the Lord our God will call. God is the one who selects. You know, the Bible says over in Romans, where it starts off telling us, and we know that all things work together for good for them who love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. Then he goes on to say, but them he did foreknow, he did predestinate to become the image of his son. So God knows in advance those who will accept Jesus Christ. He elects and selects those who he knows will accept the Lord Jesus Christ. So we get a chance to see man's responsibility and also divine sovereignty here. Then we finally, let's look at the results. It said, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received the word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. So we see the power of Peter sharing the good news of Christ, the Spirit of God working on their hearts, convicting them to make them realize that, yes, I do need to repent, for I want to have a relationship with God. And accordingly, 3,000 that day stepped up and said, Lord, I want to be yours. I want to give myself to you. So we see that the preaching of the message has power and it impacts. Remember, Isaiah told us that God's word doesn't return void. So as we stick clearly and precisely to God's word, he then, in the power of his spirit, uses that to convict those who are he has called to come and accept the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so we have looked at the proclamation, we've looked at penetration. Now let's look at propagation, how this the conclusion of this in verses 42 through 47. Notice it, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Remember, we concluded the discussion we just had on penetration with the sovereign choice of God. So this whole thing, this whole salvation thing, never lose sight of it. We are instruments. Those who know the Lord Jesus Christ are instruments that are being used, but salvation is a work of the Lord. So now let's look at propagation. First of all, the conduct. Notice how the church, this is the new church. And notice how the new church responded. There are several things that we need to focus on that the early church did that we need to maybe assess where we are in doing the same thing. Notice that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayer. So the first thing they focused on, it says, the apostles' doctrine. Remember, the apostles are messengers that were called by God, primarily the disciples that were operating under Christ. And then we know Paul was eventually called to be an apostle. And they were given specific direct directions by Christ, by the Holy Spirit. In fact, Christ made the statement that they would receive even more insight and awareness of who he is and would be able to unfold more and more over in John, be able to unfold more and more of that knowledge. These men were specifically picked so that there could be a precise indication of the fact that this is the truth that God wanted shared. And earlier, we'll see a little bit later, earlier it referenced how God, how Christ performed many signs and wonders to verify who he was, that he was the Christ. And we'll see as we go through here how the apostles also performed many signs and wonders to validate the fact that they had been chosen by him to deliver these truths so that the church would understand who it was and what work it should be about. And so the first thing they did is they focused on the apostles' doctrine. It's one of the reasons we have such emphasis on Christian education here at Mount Olive. It's imperative for us to study the Word of God. The apostles' doctrine is now the Bible that we have. So it's important for us to be into the Bible and follow exactly what the Bible tells us about who Christ is and who we are because of him. And then not only were they focused on doctrine, but they were focused on fellowship, encouraging, being connected to one. Fellowship comes from the Greek word koinonia, I mean being in common, being connected, being in communion with one another. And that's what they were. They stayed together. And notice, give like some examples of how this fellowship was manifested. It says, in the breaking of bread and in prayer. So they shared meals together. This could have some implication of the Lord's Supper, but also just in general eating. And one of the things that we really miss during this pandemic, there have been times when typically we would set aside during the course of the year, where after service we would come together and break bread together and fellowship with one another. But it's imperative for us to be intimately connected with one another. We should not look at our brothers and sisters in Christ on Sunday morning and just casually move on by. But we should be in love with one another, encouraging one another, focused on what it is that goes on with each one of us. You remember over in Galatians where Paul tells us we should bear each other's burdens. You shouldn't go by and see a brother and sister who's hurting, and you can sense that hurt, without reaching out to see what, if anything, you might be able to do to alleviate it. So we're supposed to be connected, well connected to one another. And it says breaking of bread, and then notice how important prayer is. We must constantly lift up our voices to the Lord so that we can be in alignment with his will. Prayer is not for us to just sit up with our laundry list, Lord, I want you to do this, Lord, I want you to do that, Lord, I want you to do the other thing. But prayer is for the purpose of us being able to hear him direct our lives so we can be in specific alignment with what he intends for us. God created us for a reason. There's no more joy than living out your life in the specific reason that God has brought you here. And the only way we can do that is by studying his word and by prayerful communion with him and then interacting with our brothers and sisters so we can get a sense of the place that we should be fitting in this world. So their conduct was one of focusing on God's word and being in tune with him. And then there was this fear came upon every soul. In other words, there was this great reverence for God that came over them when they recognized that he was the one who is orchestrating and leading everything, and he is the one who is providing them this great opportunity to partake of what life is really about. And notice, I mentioned a little earlier, about Christ doing signs and wonders. Notice what it said, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. The apostles specifically were given these unique signs indicating that this is what God was doing. Wonders indicating the miraculous things that they were doing. And so God used signs and wonders through the apostles to validate the fact that he had chosen them to be the deliverers of this great message, the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then notice the communion, and all who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. Now, several commentators indicated one of the things that may have driven a lot of this is that the expectation that the rapture was going to come fairly quickly. But the mindset of being there to help your brothers and sisters in their need is something that should be transferable from that church to our church today. We should be very sensitive to the needs of those who are our brothers and sisters in Christ. We should be as helpful as we can to the world because it's an instrument that brings attention to Christ, but particularly we should be sensitive to and doing all we can to assist our brothers and sisters who are struggling in life. That's the example that this early church set. And notice that they had all things in common. Now, one of the things that happens when you realize that you don't really own anything, you're just a steward. We're just stewards of God's gift. And when we realize it doesn't belong to us and it belongs to God, it's very easy to view it as a common tool or resource that can be shared to help anyone who is in need. So we're really blessed when God gives us, when he floods us with these resources. But we should be a conduit and not a stopgap. Reverend Adams used to say all the time, can all you get and get all you can and then sit on the can. We shouldn't be like that. We should look at the things that God has made available to us and share wherever we can to help whomever we can. And then notice it said, sold their possessions, divide them among all as anyone had need. So whoever needed anything, the church was there to do what they could to alleviate that need and help that person. And then finally, the conclusion, and they continued daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, and they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and have favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were saved. Now what we see is that this was a continuum. This was a lifestyle of the church. This is the way the church operated. Daily they were focused on studying God's word and fellowshipping with one another. They would meet in the temple and teach, and they would go to house. Back in this time, we didn't have churches like we have here in Mount Olive. Typically, that was a temple, and they were able to meet in the courtyard of the temple, and they would do that, but they would also go to individual homes to meet, study God's word, to pray, to interact with one another, to encourage each other. It's an example for us. We should be interacting with each other. We should be encouraging each other. We should be reaching out and connecting with each other at all times. And as the church operates in such a fashion, what happens is God is able to show the world how blessed it is to be a part of his family. And in turn, people will continue to come in and the church will continue to grow. This is a wonderful lesson for us, an opportunity for us to reflect on the church, the early church, and how it operates, and then think through where are we? What are the things that we can learn from the early church that in turn we should have in operation now? God did not establish the church and allow those things to happen randomly, but there was an intent and a purpose behind all those, particularly with studying his word and fellowshipping and encouraging one another. All right, so as we wrap up our study today, let us reflect on the implications of the lesson for our lives. First, we must be convicted and committed ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter had walked closely with Christ for three plus years and had seen his uniqueness. However, he had been inconsistent in following the Lord until the great realization that Christ had not only lived miraculously, but had died for his sin and rose from the grave for Peter's justification. Do you see Christ the same way? If so, it will position us, do we see Christ the same way? If so, it will position us so that we can be bold like Peter and have an unwavering desire to share this good news that Christ can save from the guttermost to the uttermost. I used to like Reverend Dillon when he said that, from the guttermost to the uttermost. Next, our message must be concise and precise. Jesus is the only way to salvation. Then we should reflect a lifestyle of love and compassion for others, particularly other saints. As Paul surmised, let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, we should do good to all, especially to those of the household of faith. And finally, we should be a joyful, loving church that will touch the lives of others and make them want to be part of our family. As Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord is our strength. And Christ told us, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And Peter tells us, love covers a multitude of sin. Love positions us so that we are just attractive. Love attracts, pulls. So the love of Christ and the joy that he provides should be manifested in our church. On Sunday mornings, we should just have a great, great time being able to stand together to worship and praise the only true and living God. What a blessing it is to be one of his children. Let us put on display the beauty of holiness of the Lord Jesus Christ. May God bless you, and you have a wonderful week this week. Keep our church in prayer, keep our pastor in prayer, and keep all the craziness that's going on in our world in prayer. Next week, we'll be looking at praising God with joy over in Psalms 100. May God bless and keep you.